May 8th, 2023 meeting of the Historic Zoning Commission. I'd like to call this meeting to order. Our first item is to entertain a motion to approve the April 10th, 2023 minutes. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Tyler. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Kathy. Any additions or corrections? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
And I'll just abstain, given that I wasn't at the meeting.
Mike, I'll abstain too, please.
Does that give us 1, 2, 3, 4? That's still quorum, okay. Okay, announcements, the only thing we've got, Kelly had nothing on, is a reminder that we've got design review next Monday at 4:00. Now, are there any items to be placed on the emergency agenda? The non-agenda process by design is reserved for emergency instances. Non-agenda items shall be considered only upon the unanimous approval of all historic zoning members. Are there any non-agenda items requested? Staff? Hearing none, then we'll move to the next item. This time is for citizen comments for items not on the agenda. Open for Franklin citizens to be heard on items not included on this agenda. As provided by law, historic zoning shall make no decisions or consideration of action of citizen comments except to refer the matter to the planning director for administrative consideration or to schedule the matter for historic zoning consideration at a later date. We have several people that seem to want to talk about one item, which is the middle eight. I'm going to call your name. Please come to the podium and again, identify yourself. And as I call you up, I'm going to limit comments to 2 minutes because we have several of you and we've got a full agenda beside this. So Jessica Sowell, you'll be the first.
Hi, my name is Jessica Sowell and I live on Old Liberty Pike with my puppy Winston in a house that I bought last year. I'm 36 and was born and raised in Franklin. However, owning a house in downtown Franklin was always my dream. I own a real estate brokerage with a mission to help families make home ownership a reality. I know the family developing middle eight well enough to call them family. While I believe in their best intent for this project, my concern is for the impact. Everyone knows that your intent and impact aren't always the same, and whatever agreed upon initially could change the direction of our city indefinitely. While I'm excited about the walkability, it's no surprise I have the same concern as my neighbors. Do we need the extra level? Will there be enough parking and traffic? Is this what downtown Franklin needs, or is that the story, or is that just the story that we're telling ourselves? And what is the truth? Can we do better? Or can we do this better? I am for development. It is inevitable. And what I'll argue is if we're enhancing and supporting what Franklin is or changing it altogether. Parks, farmers market, families, ask yourself what attracts people to Franklin. What does Franklin need to support our long-standing community? Then we ask what would drive them out? Traffic, congestion, tourists, renters. If we're aiming for profit, more is better, no doubt. Then we ask, what do you think of when you think of historic downtown Franklin? What separates it from any other downtown city? If we're aiming to protect historic Franklin, I just ask that we take a beat. Never had to rush a good thing, and we don't want to be responsible for doing something we regret and can't undo. Make sure we aren't so excited for an opportunity here that we miss the real opportunity to do the best thing and the right thing for Franklin. Franklin doesn't make exceptions. We are the exception. This is why Franklin needs your protection. We as the city are counting on you as the Historic Commission. As Brene Brown would say, we're not here to be right, we're here to get it right. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Thomas Bell.
Thomas Bell, 177 Lancaster Drive. Jessica, that was fantastic. Thanks for allowing me to be here to speak before you. I'm here to talk about the middle eight. It's not that I'm against everything about it. I'm just against the size and scope of the project. I'm all for development, intelligent development, And in fact, 70%, about 70% of the folks in the overlay, the historic overlay, are concerned. Not saying they're against it, but they're concerned about something that's going on. And since they've used you, the Historic Zoning Commission, to get preliminary approval, we'd like our voices to be heard. We're asking for at least another meeting. And again, I know this might not be the venue, but you certainly have a voice, a big voice, in whether it's three stories, four stories, five stories, six stories. Your previous meetings and minutes from, I believe it's the end of January, January 30th, you too were talking about a lot of things that they had to come back to. And it was the view shed from Liberty, but I'm also asking, why not the view shed from Old Liberty? I realize it's not in the overlay, but Daniels is in the view shed, the whole side. You've asked for new elevations. We hope to see the elevations, but there's approvals and things going on that we don't have all of the information. And again, a lot of people were laughing about the NIMBY, not in my backyard. It's not in my backyard, but it's in my neighbor's backyard. We walk our dog every day up and down that street, behind it, in front of it. And it's pretty disappointing when you're trying to argue between five and six stories. And that's on Liberty, but right behind on Street A, the concept is at least six stories. So I ask you to do your job and look out for us in the name of history. And that's kind of all I have to say about that. And I appreciate your time and all you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tiffany White.
Good evening. My name is Tiffany White. I own the property at 20 Daniels Drive, the first row home behind the townhomes in Jamison Station. I've been a realtor in Franklin for 18 years, and I have a background in civil engineering. I'm opposed to the Middle Eight project with the density and building height currently proposed. I'm not against all development. I want responsible development that is fitting to the area, and this project is neither. When I purchased my home 10 years ago, I never imagined that a high-density multifamily building could be built across the street. Both my property and the project site are zoned R4. My home is on a tenth of an acre. If you apply this density to the project site, the result will be about 72 homes. Also, for comparison, Jamison Station includes just 44 residential units with townhomes and condos combined. I don't understand how representatives believe it is appropriate to change the site to allow 275 residential units, or 3.8 times the density of our little row homes at Cottages at Old Liberty. Both my property and most of the site of the East multifamily building are in the historic overlay. How is a five or six story apartment building fitting of the historic district? I ask that you slow down and really consider the height and density of this project. Have you spent time in the adjacent neighborhoods? Do you know what the street view currently looks like and what a six-story building will do to that area? The view from my living room and my master bedroom will be this six-story structure from the back. This building may fit in Cool Springs, but it is not best, most appropriate development for the gateway to historic downtown Franklin. I had to go before the Historic Zoning Commission several years ago to get permission to install a fence on my property. The night that my petition was heard was also the second reading for Harpeth Square, if I remember correctly. It was standing room only, and I assure you that people were not here to hear about my 24 feet of privacy fence. Similar to Harpeth Square, the Middle Eight is also a highly significant project that will set a precedent for future development. Anyway, I had a little bit more, but I have some handouts of this current street view of some of the properties.
Just give them to them, please. Thank you. Holly McCall.
Good evening, members. I'm Holly McCall, and I'm the fourth generation to live in my house at 158 Franklin Road since my great-grandfather bought the house in 1890. So even in my life, Jim, come on, man, I just started.
Sorry.
So even in my life, I've seen a great deal of change in Franklin, and I think it's for the better. I think those of you on this board who know me know that I am not averse to change, and I actually enjoy it. But I do value the fact that I live in a historic home, and I value my neighbors who live in their historic home. And my concern about this project is I'm not opposing it per se. I've worked in the development industry, and I'm not a NIMBY. But I am concerned about the density of this, and so I would ask that you all take your time going forward with this project, ask the developer to go back and sharpen his pencil up, take that density down a little bit, take that height down a little bit, take it down a story or two. It's just, it doesn't seem consistent with historic zoning to me. And I've known Mary Pierce for years, and I know what she's done in this town. And I trust that you guys will do the right thing on this. But yeah, I think we need more housing, but I also want to keep our quality of life for those of us who've been here a long time, and I would ask that you respect that as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Holly. Lori Hennen.
Good afternoon. I'm Lori Hennen. I live on Lancaster Drive, and I do appreciate the time that you are giving all of us. So to say stop the Middle Eight project, I'm in agreement with probably all the other members that are here. Maybe we should just really slow it down and just really take into consideration what our story of Envision Franklin is, and how does that impact and how does that reflect in the Middle Eight project. And let's also think about the factory district and how is that going to play out for that area, and does the Middle Eight fit into that, or are we trying to fit that into the Middle Eight? So I do want you to have that consideration as you go forward and you do appropriate development and ensure that those things of Envision Franklin and the factory district are the cornerstones for what the Middle Eight will become. Thank you.
Thank you. Lisa Alexander.
Hi, my name's Lisa Alexander. I live at 160 Lancaster Drive. I was one of the people who helped organize Stop the Middle Eight, and we named it Stop the Middle Eight for two reasons: to get your attention, but also because we all agree that this land should be developed, that we need more housing in Franklin, but we want it stopped at this size and scope. We're a coalition of many Franklin residents who are concerned about the lack of community input that was considered during the initial approval and the lack of awareness about this project. I remember a time when a newspaper was delivered to my house. I have to say, I used to read it a lot more then. When I receive it in an email, it just gets buried in my inbox. People living even less than a block away were never informed about the Middle Eight and were not aware of the project. Such a large project like the Middle Eight will have lasting effects, altering the character and charm of historic Franklin. We are asking for a size reduction in the project scope and the number of units to better fit the surrounding neighborhood. In addition, as homeowners ourselves, we would like to see these units be not rentals, but residences, because being invested in the community is something that we all are. We care about Franklin, we care about our street, we care about our neighbors. Scott and I first got married, we were renters. It was what we could afford. And I understand the value of that, but there are a lot of rentals in Franklin. People who rent aren't involved in the community. They're not going to show up to a meeting like this, and they also don't put any tax dollars towards the city. We want people who have buy-in. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do appreciate your time.
Lloyd Crockett.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Lloyd Crockett. I live at 166 Franklin Road. Last week on the local radio station, we were referred to as NIMBYs. I'd never heard of that word before and found out from a friend, not in my backyard. Well, living only a block from this project, I think many of us feel very strongly we're very proud to be called not in my backyard. I think there are good merits to this plan. I really do. But I have two concerns, density and traffic, and the possibility of flooding. Density, think about the special projects that are now going on at the factory, at Hardinsdale Park, downtown Franklin, and then you add on to that 275 new households, 300 to 400 new cars, and you can imagine the traffic problem, the congestion that's going to happen. Add to that, with the expansion of the factory, the additional special events that are going to take place there, and the problems are going to be compounded even worse. Flooding. Old Liberty and parts of Daniel Drive lie 27 feet below the level of this 7 acres on Liberty Drive, 27 feet. We all know what happened in 2010, what happened again to a lesser degree 2 years ago. With the removal of this watershed, think what's going to happen to old Liberty Pike and the Daniels Drive. I ask you simply to please consider your early decision of going forward with this project and think about it, think about changing it, at least changing it from its current form. I think there's plenty of room for compromise on this.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Elizabeth Crockett.
Good afternoon. I'm Elizabeth Crockett, and I live at 166 Franklin Road, and I'm moving a little slowly. I just had hip surgery. I just want to tell you all what goes on in our neighborhood. I don't know how many of you all have been, but every Saturday morning we have the farmers market. This brings about 200 to 250 more cars into our neighborhood and lots of walkers, 50 to 75 more walkers. We have a policeman there every Saturday morning to direct traffic. If this middle eight goes through, this is what we're going to have all the time, all these many more walkers, all these many cars. And walking's not a problem, but the traffic could be. If there's an event at the factory, this would compound the problem of traffic and congestion. And there are going to be many events at the factory in the coming years and months. That's what the factory's there for. And having 270 plus homes across the street from the factory is going to create a nightmare for us. This project is way too big for 7 acres. This project will alter our neighborhood forever. I'm asking you to reconsider this project and come look at our neighborhood and see what 400 more cars is going to do to our neighborhood. And my question to you is, do you want 200 plus rental homes in your neighborhood? Do you all want 400 more cars in your neighborhood? If you feel no, you don't want that in your neighborhood, we do not want it either.
Thank you. Anybody else that has not turned in a speaker card? Okay, thank you. We're ready now for our main agenda. Item one, consideration of partial demolition and relocation accessory at 600 Boyd Mill Avenue. Emily?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The applicant appeared before
Need to turn on your mic, I think. Is it on?
It's on.
Okay, excuse me.
The applicant appeared before the Historic Zoning Commission during its April 2023 meeting, where the application was deferred to allow for additional discussion at the May Historic Zoning Commission meeting. The proposal includes the demolition of a circa 1980s garage and the relocation of the historic smokehouse structure in the center of the garage to elsewhere on the property. The proposal includes the demolition of an existing non-historic 1980s accessory structure that surrounds the historic smokehouse. The guidelines recommend against the demolition of historic buildings or structures if they retain integrity. Since the garage is a non-historic accessory structure, its removal is consistent with the guidelines. As requested from the April Historic Zoning Commission meeting, the application has been supplemented with additional photographic evidence of the historic smokehouse structure within the garage. The guidelines recommend that outbuildings should not be moved from their original locations unless moving is the only way to preserve them. The application shows that originally, the smokehouse was situated behind the house in the area where the current pool is located. Additionally, a new road will be constructed on the property, which is proposed to be in the same location where the garage and smokehouse currently reside. The application provides three locations where the smokehouse structure is proposed and is proposed to be located on the property. For option A, the proposed location for the smokehouse will be by Glass Lane and be situated next to the stormwater drainage area. The guidelines do not support this location as accessory structures are to be placed in traditional locations behind or to the side of the principal building. Therefore, option A does not meet the guidelines nor the zoning ordinance for this location. For option B, the proposed location for the smokehouse will be situated northeast from where it is located currently, closer toward the historic house. Moving it to this location moves the structure from where the new road will be constructed. This location meets the guidelines for placing accessory structures in traditional locations behind or to the side of the principal building. Additionally, by situating the structure at this location, it then remains on the property on which it was originally constructed. For option C, the proposed location for the smokehouse will be situated at the end of the new cul-de-sac near Boyd Mill Avenue. The guidelines do not support this location as accessory structures are to be placed in traditional locations behind or to the side of the principal building. The location of the building would also not be historically accurate as smokehouses are typically located closer to the house. The guidelines recommend that structures that are moved or have been relocated into a district utilize a plaque or marker stating that the original construction date, original location, and moving date. Staff recommends that the demolition of the circa 1980s garage addition be approved along with the relocation of the smokehouse to location B with the following conditions. A plaque or marker stating the original construction date, original location, and moving date shall be placed on or by the relocated smokehouse structure. The application must meet all the requirements of the City of Franklin prior to the issuance of a demolition permit, and any additional changes to the approved plans must be returned to the Preservation Planner or the Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. Thank you.
Thank you. Would the applicant please come forward?
Good evening, everyone. Mike Hathaway, 906 Studio Architects. Thank you guys for considering this item. So after our last meeting, we were able to go out to the site and do a little more extensive search. And as those who got into the inside of it, the structure is in great shape, surprisingly. So we definitely want to save that structure.
The smokehouse.
Of the smokehouse, mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Also, the roof itself is in decent shape. There may be some things as we move it that we may have to repair in kind, but we anticipate wanting to save that as much as we can. The floor is pretty much rotted out, so we're going to have to do something new there. And then if you look at the photographs of where it was before, there was some stone piers under the corners. We would like to replicate that as much as we can in the new location. We're in agreement with all conditions of the city staff, except for we would like to keep the options open on the location, and I'll tell you why. The main house, Magnolia Hall itself, is being purchased by an individual client. We've talked to them about locating the smokehouse on that property. They haven't said totally yes that we would love to. They're open to it, but we'd like to keep that option open as we consider locations for relocating this. So if we had our preference, we would like for you to allow us to have all three locations as options as we talk with this homeowner and decide where we're going to put this. A is still a preference, and the other consideration, I know the guidelines is, as you know, guidelines are guidelines, and they don't cover every situation that ever came up. So this, in our mind, is unique in that we've got a four-sided house. It's got a frontage on 96. It's got frontage on Boyd Mill. Visibility from all four sides. So if we put this in the rear on option A, push it back behind, we're concerned that it's not going to be available, visible for the neighbors and others to see as they come into the property. Option B, yes, it is behind the house, but it is definitely visible from Highway 96 West. Option C is a consideration for us if the homeowner doesn't want that on their property. So that's why we'd like to understand the city's comments about B being the only option, but we would like to have an option to be able to choose any three of those locations. Otherwise, I'm open to any questions you have.
Okay, are there any citizens wish to comment on the application? Hearing none, then we need a motion, commissioners.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion to permit the smokehouse to be relocated to the location identified by staff as option B. And to the extent there needs to be a motion to approve the demolition, it's a little unique because the 1980s building, I don't think would need that motion, but because the smokehouse is integrated into it, to the extent that that's necessary, I'd make the motion to approve that demolition and include staff's requirements as set forth in the report as part of the motion.
Is there a second to Josh's motion?
I'll second that, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Brian. Comments?
Yeah, I'm I think I agree with staff on the option B, and I'm reluctant to give the options to move it because I don't think it's as well interpreted in other places. It belongs to the house, and you know, even if the new owners were standing here saying we don't want that building, we would say, well, you can put in an application for demolition or to move it somewhere else. But it would be even hard pressed for me at that point to go, well, sure, you've been with this house for 150 years, sure, move it wherever, however long it's been. So I really struggle with that. I think B is the best option here in this particular circumstance. Whether the new owners want the building or not is for you to talk with them about.
I appreciate that.
I mean,
any other comments?
My only comment would be thank you for saving that building, recognizing its significance. It's unique to Franklin with that pyramid roof on the smokehouse. And, you know, you look at the construction from the pictures, it's mortise and tenon. I mean, that is an old structure.
Agreed.
So thank you.
Any other comments? Ready to vote. All in favor of the motion to move to option B and approve the demolition of the structure surrounding the smokehouse, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Item two, consideration of demolition accessory at 600 Boyd Mill Avenue. Same property, different structure. Formerly structure. Emily?
The proposal includes the demolition of an accessory structure at 600 Boyd Mill Avenue that was significantly damaged during a recent storm. The building collapsed and is no longer standing. The structure appears to be an agricultural-related structure, and the age of the structure is unknown. The National Register of Historic Places nomination form for the property, completed in August of 1975, lists the original smokehouse, spring house, and kitchen remaining on the property. The nomination does not list the structure under consideration for this demolition request. Per the guidelines, demolition may only be approved if the Historic Zoning Commission deems one or more of the following conditions met. Staff believes that the relevant condition that this application meets is if a building has lost its architectural and historical integrity, its removal will not adversely affect the district's historic character. Loss of integrity must be substantiated with photographic documentation and a physical description of the property that addresses the relevant issues. Despite the age of the structure being unknown, the building is no longer standing, and therefore the structure no longer has architectural or historical integrity. The applicant has provided photographic evidence of the collapse. Staff recommends that the demolition of the accessory structure be approved with the following conditions. The application must meet all the requirements of the City of Franklin prior to the issuance of a demolition permit, and any additional changes to the approved plans must be returned to the preservation planner or the Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Applicant.
Not a lot I can say here. We have a tree that has taken our building away, and it would be difficult to do anything with it. So I appreciate your consideration of a demolition permit.
Are there any citizens who wish to comment on this application? Hearing none, need a motion from the commission.
Mr. Chair, I move to approve demolition with staff comments.
I'll second.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Scott. Discussion? Any comments? Ready to vote? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Done.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Quickest ever.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Discussion of alterations at 432-438 Main Street. Karen Cochran, applicant. And Emily. We'll let her go first. Ms. Cochran, Emily, she'll talk and then I'll turn it over to you. You're fine, just.
The white building at the Five Points intersection was constructed in 1923 and placed on the National Register of Historic Places in 1985. The applicant appeared before the Design Review Committee during its December 2022 and April 2023 meetings and has done an extensive research that provided samples that are a close match to the iconic green and white bricks on the white building. The application involves replacing the damaged green and white glazed brick on the building and replacing it with a similar glazed brick. The applicant has worked diligently to find a glazed brick that closely matches the existing brick on the building. The green glazed brick will be removed from the higher elevations and replaced if it is in poor condition, and the intact brick will be utilized at the lower level of the building to replace the bricks that are in poor condition. The guidelines recommend that masonry on commercial buildings should be preserved to maintain the original exterior masonry walls and details. If the masonry needs repair or if it is in poor condition, one should replace damaged masonry with new masonry, which matches historic masonry as closely as possible in color, texture, and profile. Based on the samples that were shown in the application and what were seen at the April Design Review Committee meeting, the green and white glazed bricks are a close match to the existing bricks. Additionally, the mortar will also be replaced due to its age and will be color matched to what is currently on the building. The guidelines recommend when repointing is needed, one should use mortar to match the original in composition and appearance. New mortar joints should be raked to match the original profile. Materials such as stucco or drivet should be applied. By replacing the bricks that are in poor condition and moving the intact green glazed bricks from the higher elevations to the more visible lower elevations, it meets the guideline that states that one should preserve historic building elements that contribute to building style and the historic character. Staff recommends the replacement and the repair of masonry brick at the White Building be approved with the following conditions. The application must meet all the requirements of the City of Franklin prior to the issuance of a building permit, and any additional changes to the approved plans must be returned to the Preservation Planner or the Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Ms. Cochran. Samples.
Thank you. Mr. Roberts, can Julie hand out some photographs in groups, and then all can share.
We've got some of them. Is it the same photographs?
Yeah, it's up to you. It may be good to have
them
close and personal.
I think we've got photographs that we need.
Do you have this picture?
You can.
Yes, no, you do. Okay. All right, sure enough. Here, I'll give you this. I want you all to meet Julie. She's the building manager at Five Points.
And before you even start, I thank you for this detailed analysis and procedure. I just thought it was excellent.
Well, I appreciate that very much. I started on this over a year ago and hired Centric Architect to come and do an evaluation of the building. And they use Wasco masonry who has done both Centric and Wasco. I've done lots of work in Franklin, and I personally trusted them a great deal to help me with it. What I am wanting to do, and Emily and Joey and I met, what, 3 weeks ago, would you say? Again, at the building for like the 20th time. We had found a couple of more brick that we really wanted to take a look at, and I wanted to see if my mason could get a hold of them. At that time, he looked at the building again and said, you know, Karen, I really think that this green is as good as we're going to get ever. The white is as good as we're going to get. But I really think what we ought to do is replace all the horizontal lines on the top, on the three long horizontal pieces, all of those, leave the square at the very top and the diamond that is over the Starbucks window at the very top, leave those because they're in pretty good shape, or replace perhaps one or two of them. And then, so that all the green then is consistent. And it's not, even though the other brick looks, you know, the brick looks so very, very similar, when you put it up against all the different shades that the brick has turned now, you've got like five or six different shades. And I think it would wind up looking very modelly, and so did Centric. So they were suggesting to do the three horizontal lines in this new green, in this new green brick, and then take the good green brick and move it down to the base and replace all of the chipped brick at the base. So that would be the base running, some of the base running along Fifth Avenue and then all of Main Street. So that made a lot of sense to us, I think, when we were meeting, if I'm correct to say that. But I think we liked this, we liked this green brick was the best one we have. Now I've been in the process of locating enough of it, and I think we're making good progress. I'm pretty sure we're going to be able to find it. It may take a while to get it all, manufactured and brought over, but I would like for you all to consider, so I can give my mason the okay to go ahead and contract to buy it, and we can set a time in his schedule to start working. And I also want to talk to y'all about the issues of scaffolding, too, because that is going to be, if this is the body to do that with.
I don't know that it is.
Okay.
But
Mr. Chair, I believe that's a codes matter.
I'm sorry.
It's a matter for the Building Neighborhood Services Department.
Okay.
So that would not be discussed here.
Mr. Tosh back there will be in charge of that. Okay. Well, let's stay with the first part of this then.
Yes, sir.
Are there any citizens who wish to comment on this application? Hearing none, then we need a motion from the commission.
I would make the motion to approve with staff comments.
Thank you, Mary. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Scott. All right, discussion.
Any project that we approve has to meet Building and Neighborhood Services, and they will address the scaffolding.
Right, that's what Joey and Randall said.
My only comment would be, because this is such a high-profile project, and I know this is a minor tweak, but the staff comment says any additional changes have to be returned to the preservation planner or the Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. And I really think that this one probably rises to the level it ought to come back to the commission. So that would be, I guess, I would make
an amendment.
I'd make a motion to amend Ms. Pierce's motion to require any changes to come back to the commission itself.
I'll second that, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Brian. Any comments on that amendment?
Well, I think the way it was written, I guess it left to the discretion of the preservation planner to decide. I agree on a bunch of stuff, but if it's something non-substantive, if it's picking the mortar, yes. If it's decided
well,
to put
it,
you
it's
know.
I think that's the spirit of what you're saying.
Yeah. Okay, just, I'm good. I mean, I'll support it.
And we could get into the granular
I'll
nature.
I'll support it.
My only thought is, like, for example, if the manufacturer all of a sudden said, we're not that manufacturer, we're not a business, and we can't make
I
that
agree
brick,
with that.
And then all of a sudden
yeah.
we've got an alternate pick. I just don't want there to be any. I just think that's.
I get that.
We've spent so much time on this one.
I get it.
That's my take.
And Ms. Cochran has too.
Yes.
She has. Right.
Any other comments before we vote on the amendment? Kathy.
I just want to thank you for your attention to detail on this and concern and love. And it's going
well,
to
thank
be beautiful.
Well, thank you, Kathy.
It's going to be beautiful.
I do love that building.
It shows.
Okay. With that being the last comment, then, all in favor of the amendment to require any changes to come back to zoning, Historic Zoning Commission, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That's unanimous.
Okay.
Okay, any other comments? The only comment I would have is just, and it wasn't in staff comments, so I think it should be, this great detail that I alluded to a minute ago, I think that needs to be a part of the staff comments and recommendation. The procedure, the process that's to be undergone. So if somebody would make that, that'd be a second amendment, I guess. If somebody would include, say that, that would be great.
I'll do that, Mr. Chair.
Is there a second then, Mary, to the Mary's amendment?
I'll second.
Thank you, Tyler. Any discussion? Okay, ready to vote. On that amendment, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Now we're back to the main motion as amended twice. So any further discussion? All in favor then of the motion as amended twice, please say aye.
Aye.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Another step.
Yes.
Yes.
Just another step, but it's in the right direction.
Yes.
It'll be great when it's done.
Thank you.
Okay, consideration of alterations, screen porch, dormers, skylights at 800 Fair Street. Amanda McCreary. Joseph Bryan, first is on the top of this one.
Yes, sir, thank you. The applicant submitted an application for several alterations and an addition to the home located at 800 Fair Street. The scope of work includes a new rear screen porch addition, the addition of two side dormers, replacement of the front dormer window, the installation of three skylights, and removal of an existing roof vent. The size, location, and placement of the rear screen porch is consistent with the guidelines. The new porch, measuring approximately 343 square feet and located at the rear of the home, along with the 80s era addition, measures just under the 50% threshold for new additions of the existing or historical footprint of the historic home. Exact materials have not been specified, but should match or be compatible with the materials of the existing home. Plans also include the installation of a new rear door to the 80s era addition to access the new porch. New door openings are recommended to be at the side or rear elevation away from public view, so the request for a new door can be supported. Pull that up here on the screen. This is the door I was referring to, if you look up the screens. In regards to the new dormers, the guidelines recommend that new dormers be added only to side or rear elevations and that they should relate to the style, scale, and proportion of existing fenestration. The location of the dormers on the non-historic portion of the home, as well as their size and styling, are consistent with the guidelines. The applicant has also indicated that they intend to replace the front dormer window in order to make it operable. The front dormer window appears to be a single pane window However, it is difficult to determine if the window itself is historic or if its current condition warrants replacement. The guidelines recommend against the replacement of historic windows, encourage repairing rather than replacing. The applicant is requesting to add three skylights, two to the main form of the home and one to the 80s era addition. The applicant is proposing to use a flat tunnel style skylight that appears flush with the roof line. The guidelines recommend that historic roof form should be preserved and that skylights should be positioned so that they are not visible from the street. The two skylights on the right side of the home are sufficiently placed to the rear of the home or obscured from view from the street. The skylight on the left side of the home is positioned in front of the existing chimney so it may be more visible. The removal of the existing vent can be supported. So staff recommends approval of the application with the following conditions: that the applicant must submit porch materials and door specs to planning staff prior to issuance of a building permit. Should the front window replacement be approved, the applicant must submit window specs to planning staff prior to issuance of a building permit. The applicant must relocate the left skylight to a location that better meets the intent of the guidelines, and that they meet all the requirements of a building permit. It should be a building permit, not demolition permit. That is a rather large typo there. So just ignore that. We'll get that changed. So that should be issuance of a building permit. And that any additional changes to the approved plans must be returned to the preservation planner or the Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. And happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Amanda McCreary. I'm with Chisel Workshop. We do not want a demo permit, so we're okay there. We are looking to, as I was here for DRC last month, we are looking to get the second floor of this structure livable. We have clients that would like to stay in this home and grow in this home. Yeah, there are families on Fair Street, so that's exciting. Got a couple of them, actually, that we're working on. So with this project from last month's DRC, took some of your comments and took them to heart. And we did keep the dormer that's on the right side the same size as proposed in the DRC. And on the left side, we did look at expanding it and putting the egress windows on the rear left dormer as well. You can see that in the floor plan, so it can start to service the egress window for that front portion of the house, the old historic pyramidal front portion of the house, with that egress window through the back hallway. We would like to make the front window operable as well, though it won't serve for an egress window. Still, for my peace of mind as an architect, I would like for that to be operable should it be needed in case of emergencies. Also, with regards to the skylight, I would call those sun tunnels and not skylight. When we are here at DRC, we propose full-on egress skylights. We're coming back with the sun tunnels. If we can go to the last page. There is some existing roof vent up there now. The sun tunnels used to have the bottom left picture is the standard sun tunnel picture, but they do have some lower profile options now for the roof, including the bottom right, which really looks no different than the vent that is existing on the front of the house and in front of the chimney. We could also go with the flat style. The flat style, I think, does read a little bit more like a skylight, but that bottom right one reads a little bit more like a vent. And that's all I have.
Okay. Are there any citizens which comment on this application? Hearing none, then let's do this, unless y'all want to do something different. I just wrote this down. Let's talk about this in a motion to screen porch first and then the other pieces as a group second, if we could do that, just kind of simplify things. So if we could take the first item on the screen porch, and is there motions for the screen porch?
So moved.
Thank you, Mary.
I'll second that.
Thanks, Josh. Any comments on the screened porch? Hearing none, all in favor of the screened porch addition, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, now we're ready for the rest of it, which includes the two side dormers, the front dormer window, and the installation of the skylights and the removal of the existing roof vent. motion.
I'll move for approval of staff comments.
Thanks, Scott. Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Thanks, Kathy. All right, discussion.
Can we pull the Sun Tunnel out of that grouping?
We can do whatever.
Like you had done the one on the screen porch, what? Like you had done for the screen porch.
Well, the Sun, okay. All right, we'll exclude the, so it will be, we'll just, if the, if Scott is in agreement, we'll just pull out the, what was the name of it? The skylights, they're called, on the application.
I amend my motion to exclude the skylights.
Thank you.
So, Mr. Chair, can you clarify what the motion currently is?
The motion will be to approve the two side dormers, the replacement of the front dormer window, and the removal of the existing roof vent. That's what this motion is right now. Everybody got that?
So for discussion of the front dormer window, I'd like to hear again the reasons, since it doesn't meet the egress requirement of code for the size. Rather than replacing, have you explored making that window operable?
I think we would like to. It's a fixed window now, completely screwed in. It doesn't even have, it's just a sash. It doesn't even have a frame in it. It is just screwed to the 2x4. I think we could explore that. I think the concern when talking with Michael Lee's crew about it is that because it doesn't have an appropriate sash to make it operable, even if we were to hinge it, there's not enough trim on the outside to start to fix that, but I think we can explore that as an option for sure, and then come back to staff if that's not feasible.
I think you could hinge it from the interior. You wouldn't hinge it on the exterior anyway.
You wouldn't. Well, from an if we were to get a new window, we would do an awning style window that would hinge to the exterior.
You'd want it to open to the exterior.
If it was new, yes. An awning style, yes.
I've seen that those type windows here, a lot of times are used in transoms.
I know. It's kind of what it looks like.
It's kind of a transom window. Mm-hmm. It looks original to me.
I think it is.
I would like to make an amendment that the original window be retained and preserved. And if you make it operable, I mean, that'd be ideal.
Right. Not just for not a means of egress that's not really an egress, but also just to get some
airflow
from the back window to the front.
I'd second that motion.
That upstairs is not occupied now, is that right?
It is not. It's been framed in at some point in time, okay. But it's not occupiable.
Clear. I understand the need for air. Okay, Brian, all right, we've got an amendment to make the original window hingeable.
And to retain the original window. That's the main point. They make it operable, that's great.
Right.
Okay.
That's the front dormer, right?
Right.
Yes, front dormer window.
Window.
And Josh seconded it. Any other discussion on that amendment? Okay, hearing none, then ready to vote on the amendment. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, and no opposed. So we'll go back then to the original motion as amended. We've approved the side dormers, the front dormer window as amended, and then the existing roof vent. So that's where we are right now. Are there any comments on the side dormers or the existing roof vent? The removal of the existing roof vent. All right. Hearing none, then all in favor of the motion as amended, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? All right, now we're back to the flat tunnels.
The sun tunnels.
Sun tunnels, excuse me.
Sun tunnel.
Excuse me.
Uh-huh.
Or the standard dome sun tunnel.
Mm-mm. Yes. So there are four, like I was saying earlier, there's three options for the cap piece. So the standard, which is probably what you've seen before, we actually put, you all approved one of these, it was on the rear, but on West Main, and at the time, the bottom left is the only option. They do now have two more options, the flat sun tunnel detail in the top right, and then the bottom right is a lower profile. If you look at the first, can we go back to the first, see that on the first or second sheet with all the photos? So on the front, it might be the next sheet. Sorry, I've got my glasses on. Okay, so on the left side, I know that's the one that staff commented on because it is placed in front of the chimney. It would actually be a smaller profile than that roof vent that's there. So it would be below that roof vent, and it's to keep it symmetrical with the other side, which would be behind the fireplace, so we can get even light into that front room.
So what's the difference in the two? Really, I mean, from a...
The two options?
Yeah.
One's flat and one's domed.
That's it?
That's it. Yeah, they're the same interior. It's just the cap that goes on the roof. One is flat and one is domed. And then the dome one just looks more like a vent, which we see typically throughout the historic district. I don't have a preference on one or the other.
Okay. Well, I jumped out of order. I need a motion.
14?
Mm-hmm.
Let's get a motion to approve something. That's my bad.
Chitty-chatty over
Sir,
here.
Kathy, you?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to approve the sun tunnel vent model.
Sun tunnel vent model, okay.
Is that the lower right?
The
low profile. The bottom right.
Got it.
Similar to the...
Low profile dome sun tunnel.
Not that one.
Yeah.
That one.
Lower right. That's the lower right. Yeah. Oh, that. Yeah, that's it.
Not the gopher hole.
Not the what?
The gopher hole.
The gopher.
Gopher dome.
All right, is there a second to Kathy's motion?
I'll second it.
Thanks, Scott. Discussion.
I'm curious as to why we're not looking at the flat sun tunnel installed rather than the dome.
Is it that it looks more like a sun, like a skylight, as opposed to the something that looks more
contemporary
like a
looking?
Is that the concept?
I think that was the concern. Yeah. Yes.
But the dome that's on the table is going to be clear, unlike a vent at top, right?
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
I don't know how. Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of like a window though. When the lights are off, it reads as dark.
Okay.
I don't think a lot of light goes back through those.
Tyler, were you going to ask about the size? Because that was one of my questions
different
too,
sizes,
man.
We weren't looking at a 14. I think we were looking at a 12, if I remember correctly.
Is that similar to the size of the vent?
It is. I actually think the cap on the existing vent is bigger than what's there.
Yeah, I don't, to be honest, I don't particularly like any of them. You know, I do agree that the low profile looks the most like a vent of some sort. And I keep trying to convince myself that, oh, it'll just look like a vent, and it will somewhat, you know. And if they renovated the interior and needed to put a vent stack for plumbing in, they mm-hmm. wouldn't even ask. They'd poke a hole and there'd be a PVC mm-hmm. pipe sticking out in the boot, and nobody would think anything of it because we see them all the time. There's one in the picture right there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, maybe I'm being more particular than I need to be, but if I had to pick one, I think it's the bottom right. I agree with that. I don't know. I look at the plan in the roof plan, and supposedly the one on the right is favorable because it's behind a chimney, but I don't think you can see anything from the front of the house. I don't know if the chimney helps. I really consider it driving down the street, and, you know, I think the flat version will look like a skylight, and the domed one looks like a vent of some sort. I don't like any of them on the front part of the house, but I could concede to the idea that you could use some daylight up there.
Mr. Chair, I would concur with what the applicant said. I don't think if you're facing the house, you're not going to see the one on the right just because of the way the house is built. It sits on the lot. You will see the one on the left. Mm-hmm. You'll get a good view of it driving down the street. Mm-hmm.
Do we have any images? I know you don't, they're not in the packet, but of what they look like at night? Because I hadn't really thought about that, but I mean, I do worry if the lights are, you know, on full blast.
Glowing orb on the roof.
That's going to come out. Yeah. Yeah, right. I hadn't thought through that until that comment was just made. But that makes me a little bit nervous about that being, especially on the front part.
I am looking real quick. They're weird. You know, they have this, they bounce, they take the sunlight in, and then they bounce the sunlight, and the light that comes through the space is real blue. It's not the same light you get from like a window type of light. Right. So sometimes they skew over right. And they L, and so that's how it bounces the light. And I would imagine that one, but I'm looking. And I don't have a solid answer for that right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, the other thing in my mind, you know, I hate the word precedent, but it's like, is everybody going to want one now?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And is that what we want to look at on every other house on the block? I don't know.
Well, yeah, I think without more, I'd have a hard time supporting that today.
I'm okay with the ones that I don't feel will be visible.
Right.
So yeah. If the applicant can come back and show mm-hmm. that they don't shine or do anything at night when the light's on in the room, that might be different to me on the one that I think is visible from the street. But I would amend the motion to approve the two that are as you face the house on the right side.
Amanda, do you some have an option where you can do a shade and block it, so you could block it at night?
I think they do.
So it would go
dark. I don't know if they do with the sun tunnels. Okay. I would have to look into that. I really don't. I'm going to drive past the one on Main Street now and go in their backyard and look at it. But I think the way the light bounces, because you can get a light kit for them to downlight them, I don't think the light goes back up. But I can't stand before you all and 100% say that.
So we better just to defer this piece for...
I would... want to defer to the one
I'm okay with that.
Staff is
yeah,
concerned.
I'm okay with that.
And approve the other two.
We can do that.
Research,
that was my amendment.
To defer.
My amendment was to defer the one that staff said she was not sure if the visibility was going to be detrimental.
I'm just wondering if we should.
Okay.
Deferring all the sun tunnels.
All of these.
Okay. That's fine. I'll move
with
to
some
defer.
Additional information.
Okay, that trumps this other then.
I'll second the deferral.
Second.
All right.
Kathy seconded. Tyler seconded.
Okay.
Yeah.
But all right. I did.
Discussion. I did.
So all in favor of the deferral of that piece to defer the sun tunnels.
I will come back as a sun tunnel expert.
That's great.
That's good.
This will expand your knowledge.
Yes.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Bye, Amanda.
There you go.
Okay, consideration of partial demolition accessory and alterations roof at 264 Natchez Street.
And Mr. Chair.
Greg Campbell, you're Mary's recusing
herself. Yeah, I'm
going
to step out of the room.
Greg Gamble.
He stepped out.
Yeah, Mr. Gamble.
He's there.
Here he comes.
Yeah, Greg, you better get in here because it's. I'd hate for Bib to have to get up here and talk. Okay. Mr. Bryan.
Thank you.
The applicant is requesting to do a partial demolition of an addition to the accessory structure located at 264 Natchez Street. Locally as the Merrill Williams House. If you'll recall, the parking location and layout was approved by the commission at the April 2023 meeting. The guidelines recommend against the removal of historic buildings from historic districts if they retain architectural and historical integrity and state that demolition may be approved by the Historic Zoning Commission if one or more of the demolition criteria are met. And the applicant has applied for demolition based on the criterion of lack of architectural or historical integrity. The detached garage building does not appear on the 1950 edition of the Sanborn insurance maps for the area. The applicant supplied information from a previous owner of the property who believes the garage was constructed around 1974, which is right on the cusp of the 50-year threshold that we would use to consider a building historic. It appears the section that is proposed to be removed was an addition to the building that was constructed at a later date. The pitch of the lean-to roof line and the siding material being different from the accessory structure lend to those analysis. Interior photos show the original garage bay opening as well as different building materials from the rest of the detached garage. Based on the time of construction and lack of any architectural integrity or unique design, the removal of the garage addition can be supported. So staff recommends approval with the conditions that meet all the requirements of the City of Franklin prior to this time issuance of a demolition permit, and that any additional changes to the approved plans must return to the preservation planner or planning staff or the commission for review and approval. Thank you.
Thank you. But the applicant, you introduce yourself for the minutes.
Sure. My name is Cleveland Salmon, an architect. And I thank you, the board, for this opportunity to present again and for considering this application. As stated, the demolition of the shed is necessary for us to meet the parking requirements for the intended use of the facility. And we're picking up 3 parking space, which we need for the intended use. The site plan was approved at the April Zoning Commission meeting. In the previous month, I think we came in, we requested an application to restore the building. So we're heading in the right direction. We just need now to meet the code requirements for parking. And we thank you for considering this, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Any citizens wish to comment on this application? Then, hearing none, we need a motion.
I'll make a motion, Mr. Chair, to approve, give a C of A on the partial demolition of the detached garage addition with staff's comments.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Josh. Discussion?
I guess my only discussion point, and maybe this is more a point of order for us generally going forward, I'm supportive of it because I read Mrs. Taylor's email about the construction date, and I know for a fact 1974 is not 50 years ago, because I would know that. And it's definitely not 50 years ago.
How would you know that?
But I guess my point is, do these need to be coming before us for approval if the structure is not yet 50 years old? And I know there was data that was requested and information provided, but that's my only larger question, because if it does meet the mark, then I think we do need to go through the criteria set forth in the ordinance.
Now, do I understand correctly that the garage structure itself older than that?
Yes. It's stamped.
Well, I understood that was not from her email. That was 1974, and the addition was later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Approximately. I mean, that was her memory.
We'll call it a shed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the point's right. Well taken. It's like, you know, is the threshold to come before us the idea that the property is just in a historic district?
Right. If it was built last year, would they need permission? I mean, that kind of goes to the point of my motion earlier, to the extent it's needed.
Yeah.
But that's really a question maybe
I think legal
at some point our legal counsel can weigh in on. Because I don't know the answer Blake to that.
Do you want me to address it now?
I don't.
Okay. I would have to look and see if there is an age requirement, but generally the idea is that this all applies because it's in the historic zoning overlay. I mean, that's where you are.
Okay.
And that's kind of the threshold to get trigger your review is changes okay. like that.
Okay.
I can research further to see if there is an age or year requirement when things like that apply, but that's generally how you get here. It looks like Kelly wants to add something.
Sure. There's a list of criteria that helps determine whether a structure is historic or not. But your purview is to review any demolition of a structure in light of the criteria. And if it's not historic, it wouldn't meet the historical integrity criteria, which is one of the options under demolition consideration.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other comments on this? Then all of the, that everybody that wants to approve this, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
This
Thanks.
Is it.
All right, our next item is consideration of alterations doors at 239 Franklin Road. Better known as the Harlansdale Barn.
Thank you. The applicant has submitted plans for the restoration and renovation of the historic Harlansdale Barn to allow it to serve as a modern event space for the city of Franklin. The scope of work includes a new roof, siding repair, addition of required egress doors, and general repair and repaint of the entirety of the structure. It is the intent of the design team to preserve to the greatest extent possible the different elements of the barn while also equipping it with modern amenities to provide for both life safety as well as convenience to give the facility a new boost of life that will sustain it through the 21st century. The guidelines encourage regular maintenance of historic structures, and the paint and repair work to the siding can be supported. The guidelines also recommend that only damaged sections of original roofing be repaired, and that if partial or wholesale replacement is needed, use materials whose composition and appearance match the historic materials. The applicant has indicated that the existing roof and rear doors are not original to, or historic to the building, so their replacement can be supported. The applicant intends to replace the roofing materials with what is currently existing, and they have not indicated the color of the new roofing material. Plans also include the installation of three new doors to meet the life safety requirements for ingress and egress. All three doors are proposed to utilize existing window openings. The guidelines recommend to preserve and maintain historic windows and historic window openings and to maintain the original space patterns and location of windows. The applicant describes the new doors as new egress doors operable from interior only. Only a single handle visible on the exterior, custom door to match shape, location, and configuration of existing windows to minimize visual impact on elevation. Two of the doors are located on the left elevation and one on the right. No new doors or openings are proposed for the front elevation facing Franklin Road. While alterations to window openings are not recommended, these egress access points are required in order to meet life safety standards and allow for the continued use of the barn facility. The new openings are located to the sides of the building and preserves the front elevation. In this instance, the installation of the new door openings can be supported. However, the applicant should save and reuse as much historic material as possible. The applicant has also indicated the addition of two removable brackets to the front and rear elevation for Wi-Fi routers to be used on a limited basis during special events. The applicant describes the brackets as a simple hook painted white to match the siding to minimize visual impact. The brackets are to the left and beneath the central gable on both the front and back of the building. Alterations to front or primary elevations are not recommended. While the brackets can be supported due to their small size and limited use, staff does recommend that they work with the applicant to see if another location that better meets the guidelines is possible. As an additional note, any alterations to the building must also be approved by the State Historic Preservation Office for this particular project. Since this is a city project, staff does not make a recommendation, but here are some potential conditions. Should the historic zoning commission approve the proposal? The color of the new roofing material will match the existing color. The applicant shall submit the roofing material specs to planning staff prior to issuance of a building permit. The applicant shall work with planning staff to see if another location for brackets is more suitable for their intended purposes. The application must meet all the requirements of the City of Franklin prior to issuance of a building permit, and should any changes be to the approved plans, must be returned to the Planning Office or Historic Zoning Commission for review and approval. Happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. The applicant, please introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Brandon Pretty with 906 Studio Architects. I'm the project architect.
Any comments that you'd like to make on the application?
No, I think that all summarized things quite well.
Okay. Are there any citizens wish to comment on the application? Hearing none, then on the commission, before we, let's just look at the different pieces. Would anybody like to pull something out? We've got siding, roof, front door, side doors, rear doors, and new egress doors, east and west. Would you like to deal with anything separately? All right. Hearing none, then we need a motion. Thanks, Scott.
I'll second that.
Tyler. Is that Tyler?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Discussion.
Mr. Chair, this project does have to comply with the Department of Interior's guidelines because of the review by the Tennessee Historical Commission. So I'm comfortable with it.
The only question I've got is on the roof. You've talked about that. Exactly what you're talking about replacing. What do you? Let's shingles, structured, what?
Shingles only.
Shingles. So
to give a little bit of context, my understanding is the roof that's on there now is not terribly old, 10 years or so, but I believe when it was put on, it was very cold outside. The fear is that the shingles themselves didn't adhere as well as they should have, so the idea is to replace.
So we're talking about shingles only?
Yes, sir. Yes, that's it. Nothing more than that.
Unless there's some surprises.
Yeah, I mean, if you've got a patch.
I got you. Like that. Okay.
From the inside, I don't see anything major that needs to be patched.
And matching the existing color?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments? All in favor, then please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Too easy. Better run.
Thank y'all very much.
Thanks, Brandon.
Thank you.
Yes.
It's just so exciting, Mr. Chair.
It is. And I mean, we've had two or three site visits, and it's really a lot of work. And I think in the end, it's really going to be nice.
And the Hayes House is moving forward.
Yeah, so it's moving forward.
Exciting.
They've come to DRC so many times, I thought we already voted on that.
It's true.
I was like, this again? I thought we already did this.
All right. Any other items?
I have one
Susan.
Thing. I think we need to congratulate someone who just graduated on Saturday.
Oh, yes. Congratulations.
Miss Emily.
That gets a double salary, doesn't it?
Ooh.
I believe that's now the fourth or fifth graduate from the MTSU Public History Master's Program. So
that's a great addition.
Awesome. Yeah.
Significant. Well, congratulations. Thank you, Susan, for bringing that up.
Yeah.
Any other items? Then motion. Do you have anything?
No, we just wanted to let the public know at home what the degree is in.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, so my degree is in public history with an emphasis in historic preservation. So,
awesome.
Good.
Awesome.
All right.
Mr. Chair, before we do end, I do have a question. So walking down North Margin Street, I noticed a house that had come before us for approval has been demolished. Not, it wasn't actually approved for demolition, but it had been demolished, and we had approved a remodel on that house, I believe.
Where on North Margin Street?
Right across from the cemetery.
Right across from what?
The
I know the house you're speaking of.
The old city cemetery.
Mm-hmm. It was in the flood area.
But it looks to me like it's been demolished.
Huh. I believe you're referring to the one on North Margin Street, right across from the cemetery, that is in the floodplain, and so it would need to be lifted up out of the floodplain, and similar to the Schuff property on 3rd Avenue, the wall, because of the, there were some structural issues dealing with building and neighborhood services, the walls needed to be taken apart, preserved, and will be reinstalled, from my understanding.
Okay, so it's similar to the Schuff property?
Yes.
Yes.
So it's not been demolished, it's in process then, I guess. Wow. Okay.
Okay, anything else? Need a motion to adjourn then, if nobody
so
else?
Moved.
Thank
so
you.
Moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Thank you, Brian. Second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you, we're adjourned.
Oh, we don't have 12 items.